is a PDA, and it can contain some deterministic PDA and non-deterministic PDA. Interesting thing about PDA is, deterministic PDA, the language, corresponding language is deterministic context-free grammar. Complement of deterministic context-free grammar is also a deterministic context-free grammar, but that cannot be said about context-free grammar, overall context-free grammar. Complement of a context-free grammar, it may or may not. So that way, deterministic context-free grammar more behaves like a regular grammar. That is a great thing. And deterministic context-free grammar like a to the power n, b to the power n, or in Sifsa's book is 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n, same language. Balance parenthesis, same language. W hash WR is all our deterministic context-free grammar language. Deterministic context-free language, it can have unambiguous, you can find unambiguous grammar for this, so that parsing trees from the left-hand derivation will be one, single one, and parsing tree from the right-hand distribution will be single one. So that is a great thing, and it behaves excellently well. And one great fact is, I'll come to this, one great fact is complement of context-free grammar is not generally context-free grammar, but rule is accepted in the deterministic context-free grammar. Complement of deterministic context-free grammar is also deterministic context-free grammar. And another thing is, deterministic context-free grammar can be parsed by a deterministic pushdown automata. And but this machine, that last classes I have told you, this is takes care of both the deterministic and non-deterministic. That's it. Because in the non-deterministic pushdown automata, it can absorb epsilon or E transition in some books, and it can put E here also. That E is different, that E is a stack alphabet E, empty. Here is the empty input alphabet. So, here it is basically, it is not consuming any epsilon here, but it can push and pop E here. That is a non-deterministic pushdown automata that is very difficult to realize in hardware to get an idea. So that like WWR, it is a non-deterministic pushdown automata. But whenever you see W, some hash WR, then we are signaling the machine some hash or any C character that it is the midpoint from till now you push, and whenever you get hash or C, you pop. So that is a deterministic. But whenever you don't supply the C or hash, that means machine can any at one point of time popping or pushing at one of this machine, it will okay. Then we say that non-deterministic pushdown automata is accepting the string. But that is very difficult to realize in hardware, because at once you have to replicate machines after machines for any possible combinations with consuming E epsilon in input. That means nothing you are consuming an input, but nothing you are putting on stack, but you are changing your state. Right? You are not consuming anything here, and you are not pushing anything here, but you are changing to P to Q. That is not possible in deterministic pushdown automata. That is a conceptually you can concept, you can have concept, but it is not real. So that's it. And another thing, I concept most of the books, dollar is in the endpoint of the stack. We'll see how the configuration of the machine is. Today we see the Sifsa's book little bit, and then the for the PDA portion, I will call it Louis this Papad Dimitri. In this book, this context-free grammar, it's shown in this V is not only variable, this V is an alphabet. You remember the variable is, this is the sigma is the terminal, that is same. The variable is V minus sigma. Remember this particular book. You can put it the grammar like this, V is the alphabet and the sigma is the terminals, and what is the variables rules is V minus sigma, that is the non-terminals or variable, and these V is any alphabet. This is only difference in this particular book, but concept is same. See here, particular rule say the same as can have some English language rule. So these basically are terminals. G means it is not word, it is a terminal, sigma. in the terminals, if there's a room, so you can find like Jim ate cheese, like noun phrase and verb phrase. Big Jim ate green cheese. This is completely understandable English. Big cheese ate Jim. So this is syntactically correct. Okay. So whether cheese can eat at a Jim or not, that is a, you can call it a, it is syntactically correct, but that is semantically not correct. That is a semantic check. A particular inanimate object cannot eat a animate object like this. That is called semantic errors. That is in compiler. First, you remember you have the, you take the token analyzer or lexical token, you get it by the only the different by a finite state machine or regular grammar. You put the tokens in the symbol table, then you use the PDS, deterministic PDS, for getting the syntax tree. Then you go for the semantic check. Semantic check means whether you are putting the characters into integers, integers into characters, floating point numbers into characters or strings, like this kind of illegal operation you are not doing. That comes partly to the semantic check. So this is a particular semantic check of any, say, language processor, but it is syntactically correct. But this grammar can produce gibberish language. So this kind of big cheese, green big cheese, this is also a possible produce of the language, but that difficult to mean. So what I want to say, the context-free grammar is can generate understandable or not understandable, but you have syntactically correct. This I have explained it in that class, and whenever you put some extra T and F and this kind of symbol, say this kind of symbol here, this is a grammar, and if you put E plus E, then you give the equal importance with plus sign and multiplication sign, but we want the multiplication sign to be earlier, because we know in all our arithmetic competition the multiplication should precede the addition. So that is the reason we incorporated E plus T rule, and T goes to T star F. So we are giving more overriding over plus. So this rule will definitely create unambiguous grammar. But if we don't have T, if we have E plus E, that is expression grammar. This is also expression grammar, and whenever you go for T for E, that is also expression grammar. But the problem with E here and E plus E here, E star E here, the problem will be you have two left hand derivation tree. Sometimes plus is giving more precedence, sometimes star is giving. So that is no. So we can modify the grammar so that modern our arithmetic rules can be incorporated. So these are the clever tricks so that you can put it into a context-free grammar so that multiplication can be ahead than plus sign. This is called a modification of grammar. This is called a expression grammar, unambiguous expression grammar. That we have given the CIFSAS example on the last class. You can see the same example, so that this theorem is interesting. Here it is, grammar is, V is, remember, this alphabet here, not variable, particularly in this book, but it is the same thing. V is the alphabet, and sigma is the input terminals, and your variable will be V minus C. So, a context-free grammar, A belongs to here, A means your variable, then A, this is left-hand side is a variable. A variable, this means yields to start, that means you are giving the star, means you're giving the more number of, you're applying the rules, that is the cleans, you can take it as a cleans closer, you are applying many rules, and finally you get the W, it is string of terminals from the sigma, and there is a parse tree with root A and yield W. There is a leftmost derivation, like one is a leftmost derivation, I always do, this is a leftmost derivation and this is rightmost derivation. But there should be one and only unique leftmost derivation for unambiguous grammar, and there is one and only rightmost derivation for the unambiguous grammar. So, for again, after the string is accepted, the leftmost derivation, generate, if you want to generate the parse tree, then you have to again traverse it from left hand, that is the LL1 parsing. You know, that is again from left hand side. Rightmost derivation we for the bottom up parsing, that is LR1, that encompass more kind of deterministic context-free grammar, that is LR1 parsing. Both way, these three, you cannot derive two rightmost derivation for unambiguous. For parsing, rightmost derivation is more suitable. So that we start from the string from the rightmost way and we try to reach it to the S starting variable, start variable, and that is good for LR1. This is for top down LL1. LL1 is less powerful. LR1 is encompass more deterministic context free grammar. Remember, there are some languages out there which are within is a deterministic context free grammar but which are not LR1. So those languages we try to avoid our in programming framework, because LR1 itself, it will take O(n) time. It is good, but LR1, the parsing table, you need a parsing table so that if this comes, you have to go this way. This parsing table is huge. Huge means it may be the 10 megabytes, or depends on your how many rules you have in your context-free grammar. In a typically programming language, say in a Python, maybe your rules may be 1,000, and the 1,000 means the space is maybe 10 megabyte, like this, this order. This is, if you have a very big internal memory for this, your parsing may be slower. So LR1 is the more or less the maximum thing. LR2, LR3, what is 1 means here? 1 means look ahead symbol. You look ahead only one terminal look ahead. LR1 is very good for this, but LR2, LR3 is a more, you can encompass more language, but those language will take lot of parsing table space in your parser. We will try to avoid. Okay, so there is always some grammars which are not LR1, which are not LL1, and maybe we cannot find the unambiguous grammar also. It is not that all deterministic context-free grammar, all deterministic context-free language have unambiguous grammar. I have told you there is no such simple rule, but it can be found. Most of this, it can be found a unambiguous grammar for a deterministic context-free language. Any question you can, this is I am telling you, this is a expression grammar, but there will be ambiguity because you both have E plus E is also available, E starts. So sometimes you give importance plus ahead, which is in our conventional mathematics not to be done. It should be start, should be ahead. So this will create ambiguity. So we try to ambiguity, we try to avoid, we can little modification, we can avoid this ambiguity by incorporating another symbol T here. Okay, so you can follow this, we can another symbol, we can T. So this is a modified grammar, G dash. Yes, this is called ambiguous grammar. You are giving importance here, you start, it is okay. Plus, it is okay because it, but whenever you give importance plus and then star, which is not okay. So this is a thing which should be avoided by tweaking the grammar. Now these things, the convention, this picture, they have used it, this particular book Harris, that we have already known in reading input stack is here. Here you see they are using same alphabets here, but here you know that we use it, this is the alphabet sigma and this is gamma. And remember, I always saying in a Turing machine, you don't have stack, you write it here itself. So their stack alphabet, they don't have stack, they have an input alphabet and another is writing, that is a called gamma. It includes some cross out symbol or blank symbol. That is the in Turing machine. Always think parallelly what is different between finite state machine, finite state machine in the regular grammar and finite state machine in the Poisson automata, same. There are only one or few more accepting states, but in Turing machine there is another finite state machine. There you have accepting states also, you have a rejecting state also. But here it is not. Here only the one accepting or one or more accepting state, but there is no rejecting state. When I know the this Poisson automata rejects, So your input pointer should be at the end, okay, and your stack should be empty. Then and also your final state machine at the accepting state, then we say the your PDA accepts the string. Okay, so that is the difference. But in Turing machine, we see this pointer should not have to be end at not to be an end. It back and forth. But here in the final state machine or in Pulsion Automata, this pointer can only go from left to right. But in Turing machine, it can go left to right, right to left, one step at a time, not more than one step. It cannot be stationary in Turing machine, but it can reject a string whenever it cannot. You have not traversed here at least one. You may not traverse, and you don't have stack there. It go to the rejecting state. So that is the difference of the machine. But that machine is more powerful. Turing machine is more powerful. Here, this is the alphabets. I am coming to this. Let's see. This is the definition of Pulsion Automata, same as the CIPSAS book, same, but only here they use the symbol K instead of Q. So that same. This is a sigma input terminal. This is a gamma alphabet stack symbol. That is same. And instead of this, they are using big delta function as a delta function there in CIPSAS, and this is the initial state. In CIPSAS it is Q0, so you must know the various convention of good famous book, and K is initial state, okay, and this is accepting states, final states, and this is the transition function. Remember here this book also, they have this particular machine configuration can take care of non-deterministic PDA. How can you see that? Because see here the input function here, if the input function, they take the any state, and the this is the input configuration of the tape. They might, we are getting for this particular book, Harris and Podhamchew, and this is the definition of this pushdown automata, and so this is the K in CIPSAS book, it is Q. This is the stack alpha input alphabets terminal, and this is the configuration of the machine. What is the configuration of the machine? This is this. That is a particular P when in which state your FSM is there, and U is the input alphabet. Okay, this is the input alphabet, and E is the pop, is the top of the stack. That is, it is a Z0 or dollar in this book. The stack is empty, and it goes to Q state. But this tuple, it consists of a two tuple, and in this tuple P is the initial state, U is the your input character terminal, and E is the top of the stack. You go to the Q is the your next state, and A is the top of the stack. This is particular, this means you are pushing A, and while this one is pop C, because here U is input and your stack is seen is the topmost, is A, and now is F7, that you are making a pop say. This particular string is the configuration of the machine. What I want to show you, you have to design in your exam to configure this machine. Here it is, the machine is the configuration. S is the start symbol. This is a particular machine. It is a WCWR. Remember, this is whenever you supplying the midpoint of a palindrome, that is a deterministic pushdown automata. Because if it is a WWR, it is a non-deterministic. But whenever you are giving C, that is a deterministic. So if you put this kind of five rules only, then whenever A is input, then you can. This is the state, and this is the unread. This is your sample string. This is ABB CBBA. That is, but if it is ABB without CBBA, then it will be non-deterministic. But whenever you are giving C rule here, that means you are giving the midpoint, and this is your top of the stack. Whenever you have this rule, then you can use the rule number 1, 2, 2, like, then you go to the final state. So if you see this, this is the particular, just go through this. It is very simple. It is a particular language is WCWR. C is the midpoint. If you just only five rules, this is the rules of this is the basically rules of your delta transition function. This is the your rule for, like, if FSM you have a, you can put it in a table, but here you cannot put in a table. You have to, like, this kind of thing, symbol. This is a configuration of the machine. Five typical configuration. Whenever you see the your top of stack E, and there is empty, and if you see A here, you push them into the stack. These rules means that whenever you see E empty, and if you see B input, you push them into the stack. How can you say push B? You can see your top of stack is visible B, your top of stack is visible A. So that is, both are pushing operation. Whenever you see epsilon on the top of stack, if you see C here, you do nothing. You just go to S to accepting state F. But it is not, it is go to the accepting state, but your input should also be empty. So whenever you are in F state, you are seeing your stack, top of stack A, and you are seeing also A, then you, what you have done, you make it a empty, you pop, okay. And whenever you top of stack B, you see here B, you are again a pop. So you, with only these five rules, you can see it here, you applying these five rules, and this is the rule number, you can go to the F state, and you can go to the unread input, because here it is, input is empty. Whenever you see your input is E, that means it is, input is NP. Whenever you see E here, that is a Z0 or dollar sign, and you have go to the F state, then you are accepted to stream. This is the configuration of the machine of this thing. This one you try at your, this is a particular language, Pujan Automata accepts the language AB star. W has the same number of A's and B's. So this is also a, it is typically not A, A to the power N and B to the power N is a subset of this language. It doesn't say, whenever you say same number of A's and B's, it may be ABAB is also language, AAB, BB, AABB is also language, like A to the power N, B to the power N. ABAB is also same number of A's and same number of B's. 3A's and 3B's, A to the power N, B to the power N. Or 2AB and then 2BA, it is also this there. So these are the language where W has the same number of A's and B's. It is typically, it is a deterministic push on automata. When whenever A's are coming, you push them on the stack, and whenever B is coming, you pop them, you match them, that's all. These are the rules. If you see the this, if you see this kind of set of rules there, 8 rules. Earlier you have got it 5 rules. You have 8 rules. You can, this is a sample string. Like A, B, B, A, B, B. You will see, you have 3 B's, 4 B's here, and 4 A's. And you can try all these symbols, and if you see, if you apply these rules are already there, you can go to the accept state.